So in today's session, primarily I'm going to cover the two topics. Okay, the first one is a web services task. Okay, and the second is a fuzzy lookup component. Okay, so here in the data transformation task, we have one of the component available over here, that is a fuzzy lookup. Okay, and we have this one more component, that's a fuzzy grouping. This both component work on a similar concepts. Okay, so and they are used for a data cleansing kind of activity. So I will just give you a small demo on this component, fuzzy lookup and fuzzy grouping. And before that, I'm just going to explain you about the web services task. That here in this control flow, we have one of the tasks as a web services task. Okay, so how we can use this task and what is the purpose of this task? So sometime in a real-time scenario, what happen is you need to download a file from some using some web services. Okay. Or you need to retrieve some value using your web services. Okay, so if you want to perform this activity using your SSIS package, or then you can just use this particular task. Like for example, there is some file that is present in the cloud. Okay, you just want to download that file from that cloud. Okay, so you can connect over there using a web services. You can just retrieve that data. Okay, you can download that file on your local machine, and then you can just use it in your solution. Similarly, if you want to retrieve some value for a validation purpose, okay, that also you can just retrieve using the web services task if it's available using a web services, okay, and you can just use this value in your solution, okay, using this particular web services task. So how we can perform this activity? For that purpose, I'm just going to give you one example, and I will just show you how we can, what are the things that has been involved in this particular task, okay. So for that purpose, just give me a minute. Let me just check whether I have a folder over here for web services or not. Yep, I have one folder over here as a web services example in our material folder. And there I have two files. One is a stock detail.wsdl and one is a stock detail.xml. Okay, what are this file? I'm just going to explain you in a minute or so. Okay, so to give you an example, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to use this one of the freely available web services. Okay, and this web services name is this particular website's name is webservicesx.net. okay, so what this web services site do is it will provide us various services, and we can connect this site to freely using our web services component, and we can retrieve a data from there. Okay, now one of the services available over here on this website is to get a stock quote. Okay, so whatever stocks are trading onto a New York exchange market, okay, for those particular stocks we can just get a stock quotes. Okay, like what is the stock's daily price, how much variation is there, what are the what is the P by E ratio, all this kind of information we can just retrieve from this website. Okay, so if I just go to the stock quote method, this stock quote web services over here, I will be able to get a window which looks something like this. Okay, and in this window it is saying that here there is one method available. Okay, and the text is written over here is the following operation are supported. For a formal definition, please review your service description. And get quote is one of the method that is available over here, which can provide a stock quote for a company or symbol. Okay, so if I just open this get quote method in a new window, in a new tab, okay, then it will just give me a window which looks something like this. Okay, so in this window basically what I can do is I can just provide a one particular stock quote, and against it, it is just going to provide me corresponding company's stock quote. Okay, so let's say I want to generate, I just want to see that how the stock of Google has been traded on the NYSE. Okay, so I can just write the symbol, like whatever symbol is being used on the NYSE for the Google, then I can just pass it over here, and after that if I just say invoke over here, it is just going to provide me one XML file. Okay, and in that XML file I'm having a stock details for a Google, like what is a company name, symbol, then what is its last price, on which date it is traded lastly, okay, what is its P by E ratio, in which range the stock is being traded. Okay, So all this kind of things, details, we can just get it over here. Okay. Now let's say we want to perform an activity where what we want to do is we want to create an exercise package in which we want to where from the package we want to pass a stock code, okay, and against that stock code we want to download this particular XML file. Okay, so this XML file we can just get it on our machine and we can just load this data into our system. Okay, so we can just display this particular stock detail on our website, or we can just use it for some analysis purpose. Okay, so if you want to perform this activity, how I can do that using SSIS package, that I'm just going to show you in this particular demo. Okay, so is everyone clear about the things that what we are trying to achieve over here? Any question on that?
Are we getting the XML file and processing it, right?
Yes, we are just going to get an XML file and we can just process it further for our own use. Okay. So now how we can do that using a web services, that I'm just going to explain you. Now, as you know that whatever we use in our SSIS package, okay, for all those things, at the back end one definition is getting created. Okay, and using that particular definition, your SSIS package will understand that what activity it has to perform. Okay, similar is the case with the web services. Okay, whenever you work with a web services, at that particular time what happen is you need to create one file, okay, and that particular file is or you need to use one particular file in your code. Okay, and that particular file is called web services definition language file, okay, or the short form that is being used for this file is WSDL file. That is a web services definition language file. Okay, so generally whenever people provide a web services, at that particular time they will also provide a reference to this web services definition language file. Like here in this particular website, if we go to this particular page, here they have provided the WSDL schema location. Okay, and if I just take this particular URL, okay, and if I just open this URL into the new window, okay, here in the new window I will be able to see its web services definition language file or a description that is written in a WSDL file. In this WSDL file, basically the definition is written, okay, that what this web services is all about, what kind of input it expect, okay, in the output what kind of value it provide. Okay, so all this kind of detail is being present in this particular WSDL file. Okay, so you can just provide this WSDL file with the corresponding component, like whatever you are using in your programming language. Okay, so once you provide this WDS file to that component, your component will also able to understand that what are the kind of different method this web services offer. Okay, and for those particular web services method, what are the input and output parameters. Okay, so these all details are just available over here in this particular file. Okay, and we just need to provide this particular file to our SSIS package. Okay, so how we can perform this activity and how we can now just configure our web services task, that I'm just going to show you in a minute. Now, anyone has any question on this WSDL file? Okay, so I believe everyone is fine with it. Okay, just for now, I'm just pinging all of you on URL on the chat window. Okay, just have this URL with me. Okay, if you are creating a solution with me. Okay, because we will be using this reference to a WSDL file into our solution, so we will be needing at that time. Okay, so just copy this URL which I have just pinged to all of you in the chat window. Okay, now we are just going to implement this thing in our SSIS package. So for that purpose, I'm just moving to my solution. Okay, and in my solution I'm just creating a new package for this. Okay, and I'm just right clicking on solution adding a new package, and I'm just giving it a name as a web services task demo. Adding it into my solution, I'm just setting it as a startup object. Okay, and here I'm just adding this web services task into my solution. Okay, so now this web services task is added in my solution. Okay, now I'm just going to start the configuration for this web services task. So how we can do that, I'm just going to show that. All of you are done with the creation of this package and all of you have copied this URL. If I'm going too fast, just let me know, I will slow. Okay. So now, I just need to start the configuration. So I'm just going to open this web services task in an edit mode. Once I open it in edit mode, I'm just going to add a window which looks something like this, where here we have this four window, input, output, expression and general. Okay. In the general window, the first thing is it required a connection details, okay, and for this we required a HTTP connection, okay. So for that purpose, I'm just going to this HTTP connection location connection, okay. I'm just creating a new connection over here, okay. I'm just clicking on the new connection, and when I click on it, it will just give me a window which looks something like this, okay. In this window, in the server URL, we are required to copy paste the URL of the WSDL file location, okay. So I have just written this, just copy pasted this WSDL file definition URL over here, okay. So I have provided it to you also in the chat window, so you can just copy paste it over here, okay. Now here, to connect to this web services, this is a freely available web services, okay. So for this web services, the client certificate or user credential are not available, okay. But if some scenario, if you have some kind of credential or certificate associated to your web services, in that case we can just enable these boxes, okay, and we can just provide the details over here accordingly. In this case, this is a free web services, so we don't need to worry about anything else, okay. After providing this URL over here, we can just test the connection. Okay, and when we just click on it, it will give you a message whether the test has been succeeded or failed. Okay, so we can just provide this detail over here. If you want to use a proxy of the web services, then you can just also provide this proxy URLs over here. So in case this service is not available, then by the proxy server you can just get those details. So for that purpose, you can use this advanced setting also, which is available over here. After providing this detail over here on this particular page where we are just providing this server URL name, okay, and after that we are just testing the connection to make sure everything is working, we can just say okay and say okay over here. So now our HTTP connection is created, which is now pointing to over this particular file, okay. Now after that, the second configuration over here is a WSDL file. So your SSIS package, you know, want to know that where is the web services definition language file, okay. Web services definition it's a web services description language file, okay, which contain the all the detail about these web services. So your SSIS package can use it for a reference purpose. So here we can create any of the blank file, okay, with the name .wsdl, okay, and we can just use it for a reference, okay. Or what you can do is you can just use right now the file that I have provided into a material folder, okay. And in the material folder, if I go to web services example file, here you can get this stock detail.wsdl file, okay. You just select this file and just say okay over here, okay. After that, just make this override WSDL file option to true, okay. And once you make it true, after that just click on this button download WSDL, okay. So what it will do is it will just connect to the web services, okay, and from the web services it will just download the latest definition of this WSDL file. So when I click on this button download WSDL, okay, what it is going to do is it will connect to our web services site, okay, that is the web services x.net, okay. It will connect to that site, and from there it will just take this web services definition language file, a description language file, okay, and it will just override the definition in this particular path which I have provided in the WSDL files section, okay. So after doing this operation, I can just say okay over here. So now I have a latest WSDL file definition. Now after doing this thing, I can just go to the input section, okay. But in the input section, based on the WSDL file definition, your SSS package will provide us what kind of services and methods are available over here. So if I go to the service section, here I will be able to see that stock code is one of the services that is available over here. So I can just select the stock code from this drop down box. Okay. Within a stock code is a method name which we have it over here. Like here we are working with a stock code as a method name. Okay. And under the stock code services, we have a one of the method as a get code. Okay. So now if I go to my solution again and if I just check the method names, in the method name I will be able to see the get code. Okay. And if I just select the get codes over here, I will be able to see this kind of changes in the bottom window, okay, where the description is added that get a stock code for a company or symbol, okay, and here we can just provide the symbol against which we want to generate the value, okay. So here I can just write a company code, like for example, let's say I write a company code for Accenture and that is ACN, okay. I'm just writing the Accenture company code over here, that I have just put it over here in this particular way. So now it will just generate a file for it will just provide us a detail for an Accenture stock code. Okay, now I can go to the output section. Okay, and in the output section I can just select the output type, that whatever output I'm getting, okay, that output I want to store in some variable or I want to store in some file connection. Okay, so if you want to store it into a file connection, you can just provide a file details over here accordingly, or if you want to store it as some variable, then you can just provide a variable reference over here in which you want to store this data. Okay, so depends on what kind of output you are getting, you can just choose any of this option. In our case, we are going to get an XML file. Okay, so I'm just choosing the output type as a file connection. Okay, and here we need to provide a file connection where we are going to store this information locally. So I'm just creating a new file connection, okay, and here we have a file that is already created, okay. So I'm just browsing the file location, and from this material folder and web services example path, okay, I'm just going to use this stock detail.xml file, okay, and I'm just going to open it over here, okay, and I'm just going to say okay over here. So what this is going to do is it will just download this file, okay, and it will store this file at this particular location based on this connection, okay. So those are the settings, we can do it over here. After that we have an expiration window, so if any of the component you want to change dynamically, then you can just set its property from this particular place also accordingly, like we have did it for our connection managers in the last session, okay. So you can perform all this activity, and once all these steps are set, input, output and general, okay, after that you can just say okay over here. So now your web services component is configured, okay. Now I'm just going to run this package, okay, and when I run this package, I should be able to see the one file over here in this folder, okay, which will contain a data for Accenture, okay. So right now the file I have over here, it contain a data for a Google, okay. So we will just run this code and we will just check what kind of data it is generating. Okay. So now I'm just executing my SSS package. So for that purpose, I'm just executing my web services task, and the execution has been started. Yep. The execution has started and it's end successfully. Okay. So now after it's done successfully, I can just stop its execution, okay, and after that, now if I go to the this particular folder, okay, and I can just see its last date modifies changed to my current machine's timestamp. Okay, and if I just open this file, I will be able to see that here I have a data for Accenture PLC, but I can just see its current price, its last traded stock caught, its earning, its P by E ratio. So all the details I can just get it over here in the form of this XML file. Okay, once I have this XML file, then I can just use this XML file further in my solution, either to load the data into my SAS package or on whatever, you know, reasons I want to just use this file. Okay, but my purpose over here is just to show you that how we can use a web services task to get data, okay, from some particular stock or by using this web services matter, how we can connect and we can just retrieve some data and save it locally on our machine. One of the more way in which you can perform this activity is you can create some variable. Like let's say here I'm creating one variable over here with the name stock name, okay, and let's say I'm just giving this variable a data type as a string, okay, and I'm just giving it some value, okay, like for example I'm just giving it a value as a Google, okay, and after that what I can do is in my web services task in the input section, okay, rather than providing a value over here directly, a hard-coded value, what I can do is I can just provide it a value over here from a variable, okay, by checking on this variable sign, okay, and after that I can just go to this drop down, and from the drop down I can just select the variable that is that I have created, a stock name, okay, and after that if I just say okay over here and if I just run this task, okay, all it is going to do is it is just going to take a value from that variable, okay, and it is just going to provide me a result accordingly. So if I create a package like this, okay, and now if I just execute this package, then I will be able to see this time the file it is going to create, it is just going to create it for a particular stock code Google, okay. So now if I just stop this execution and if I just go again and see the value in this particular stock detail file, now this time we can just see that the file is created for the code Google. Okay, in this particular manner for a different stock codes you can just get the details, okay, and you can just have their file and you can just use it accordingly. Okay, so this is all about web services task, and this is how you can just generate your data or you can just get a file from the web services locations. Okay, so is everyone able to complete this activity? Any question or any doubt on this activity, on the whatever way, on the way I have covered this solution till now?
Akshay, I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
Can you please give us a more sample, like in a practical environment, like where would we be using this kind of, what's the use of?
Okay, so for example, let's say if it's vary on very project to project thing. Okay, I have never used this web services in a practical scenario, but just to give an example, let's say if you are working on one website, okay, in which you are providing some stock related statistics, like let's say you are working on you are creating a website or you are maintaining a website which is similar to Yahoo Finance or Rediff Money or something like that, okay, where they provide a stock analysis and everything, okay. Now the place where stock is traded, like let's say New York Exchange or somewhere else, okay, this particular places they are not going to provide you access on their databases, correct? So in that case what they do is they will sell this data through a web services, okay, and in order to achieve a data from there, what happen is this particular company, okay, they use a web services, they just collect the data from there, okay, they store it locally on their server and they just use it for their analysis purpose. And that's why you will see that there is always a lag between the stock price that is being traded on the NYSE and the stock price analysis or the data that we get on the different news channels or on the different sites where they provide stock analysis details. Okay, so this can be like one of the scenario where you can imagine where this web services is, you know, getting used. Does this example make sense?
Yes, that was a good example. Yep, that's what exactly I wanted to say. Where
okay.
We will be using this.
Okay. Yep. So if you get to work in those kind of scenario where people are not giving an access directly on their databases, but they willing to share their information, then the most preferred way to perform those activities is to, you know, go for some kind of web services. Okay. And in that case, you can just use this kind of activities. Okay. Now, any other question on the web services task for sure, or can I move to the next topic? Okay, so I believe everyone is fine with this. Now, the next topic, what I'm going to show you is I'm just going to explain you two things. Okay, one is how we can execute one SSIS package. Okay. From the another SSIS package. Okay, so for example, here I'm just executing this web services task. Okay, and from this web services task, if I want to execute another SSIS package, like for example, if I want to execute this package.dtsx or geography.dtsx, okay, then how I can perform this activity. Okay, and also if I want to pass some value during that particular time, okay, how I can perform this activity. Okay, so to perform all this kind of activity where we want to execute a one SSIS package from another SSIS package, okay, at that particular time we will use one of the tasks available over here, that is the execute package task. Okay, using which what we can do is we can call a one SSIS package from another SSIS package. Okay, so how we can perform this activity, for that I'm just going to give you a small demo. Okay, and during that demo what we are going to do is we are just going to, here in this particular web services demo package, we have used one variable over here, that is a tuple. Okay, we have used one variable over here, a stock name, to which we are passing a value as a tuple. Okay, what we are going to do is we are just going to pass some value from that package to this package. Okay, that value we are going to store in this variable stock name. Okay, and then against that the web services will be executed. Okay, so how we can pass a variable from one package to another package, and how we can call one package to another package. Okay, that is what I'm going to explain you in the next demo. Okay, so to give you an example on that, I'm just going to create one more SSIS package in my solution. Okay, so for that purpose I'm just going to this MSBI training solution, add a new item, and I'm just creating a new package over here. I'm just giving it a name as an execute package demo. And I can just say add over here. So this particular execute as package demo is added, which is right now a blank package. Okay, I can just set it as a startup object. Okay, after that what I'm going to do next is I'm going to add some task in this package, and I also want to create some variable in this package. Okay, so let's say I'm just creating one variable over here with the name test code. And in this variable I'm just defining a type as a string. Okay, and here I want to write some stock code value. Okay, is anyone aware about any company's stock code that is being traded on the NYSE apart from Accenture and Google? Any stock code that is being traded on
BSC, Bank of America?
BSC, BOA or
BAC?
BAC.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, so we can just see whether here the value is available for that or not. So it's a BSC, right?
BAC.
A for Apple. Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So we can just see the value for this code. Okay, and I am just invoking it, and here we can just see the value for the Bank of America. Okay. So what I'm going to do is in this particular variable, I'm just going to store the value BAC. Okay, and from this SIS package, okay, we are going to pass this value BAC to the web services demo. Okay, and we will be and the file should generate a value for Bank of America, okay, in this case. So for that purpose, now over here in this execute package demo task, okay, we just need to add this task execute package task over here, okay. And in this execute package task, we just need to provide the details that which package we want to execute, okay. So I can just right click on it and I can just open it in edit mode, okay. Once I open it in edit mode, I will get a window which looks something like this. And in this window, we have four sections, general, package, parameter binding, and expression. Okay. In general, it's just a name and description, so we can ignore it. The second one is a package. In the package, basically, we want to first need to select a reference type. Okay. And in the reference type, we have two options. One is a project reference and one is an external reference. Okay, so in an SIS, basically you can deploy your package in a two-way or in a three-way. Okay, the first way is that you can deploy your package as an entire solution, like you deploy your web solution or you deploy your Windows solution. Okay. That particular kind of deployment which we can do, okay, where we are deploying our entire project as a one solution, okay, like we deploy our web or Windows solutions, okay, if you are doing those kind of deployment, in that case your reference type will be a project reference. Okay, now the second kind of deployment is where you deploy your packages as at an individual level. Okay, that means you are just deploying your one package as a separate entity, okay, where these packages are not relevant to each other. Okay, you are not using any kind of global parameter or anything within that particular package. This kind of deployment is called an external reference. Okay, if you are working in a 2008 R2 or below version, okay, and in that particular environment this project reference is not available, the only option was there is an external reference. Okay, that means you can only deploy your package as a individual entity and you cannot deploy it as a solution level details. Okay, so for those versions previous to 2008 R2 and including 2008 R2, this project reference option is not available. There is only one option available over here, that is an external reference, where you deploy your package as an individual entity either on a SQL server or somewhere on the shared drive. Okay, in this example I'm just going to give you a demo considering that we are deploying our SIS package as an individual entity, okay, as an external reference. Okay, this option will be more clear to you once I explain your deployment, okay, into our upcoming sessions. Okay, so here I'm just choosing the project reference. Here I'm just using a reference type for now as an external reference. Okay, and what is the meaning of that I will just explain you in some time, or it will be more clear to you when we are done with our deployment part. Okay, after that, now I just need to select a location that the external reference, that means the individual package that I have deployed, okay, where that package exists, whether that package exists on the SQL server, okay, or it exists on the file system. Okay, so in our case we have not deployed this package till now on the SQL server or somewhere else. Okay, so I'm just going to use this option as a file system over here. Okay, and I'm just going to say that this particular package which I want to exist, the web services demo or DTSX, it present as a file system on some location. Okay, after that it is asking me the connection that where this particular SSIS package exists. Okay, so for that purpose I just need to provide a reference of this web services task package that where I have created it. Okay, so I can just create a new connection over here. Okay, and in this new connection I can just browse the location where my package exists. Okay, so what I can do is I can just browse the location where I can just go to my wherever you have stored this solution. Okay, you can just go to that location. So I'm just going to my documents. I'm just going to my documents, which is to the 2010 templates. Okay, it's not here. Just give a minute where I'm just saving the package. Just give a minute. This PC documents, then Visual Studio 2010 projects. Right, I'm just this is my solution name. I'm going over here, and in this solution I have this files. Okay, so from this files I can just select my file which I want to execute over here. Okay, so I'm just selecting the file, its name is webservicesdemo.dtsx. okay, and once I select this file, and if I just say open over here, okay, this file path is just come over here. Okay, and from this place it is now going to access this package. Okay, and it is just going to execute this package. Okay, if there is any password associated to the package, you can provide it over here. Okay, what is the usage of this password and everything, that I'm just going to explain you in some time with the security features options that are available in SSIS, so it will make more sense to you at that time. And the last option we have over here, execute out of process. Okay, so what does execute out of process say is that whenever you are executing a one SSIS package, or whenever you are calling a one SSIS package from another SSIS package, okay, in that case it is just asking you over here that whether you want to execute this second package, that is our web services demo package, you want to execute this package into the same memory that is allocated to your execute package demo, okay, or do you want to allocate some separate memory to it and you want to execute it over there. Okay, so based on your requirement and the package size you have, okay, the data load size you have, you can just select this option to true and false accordingly. Okay, after that, this parameter binding is not applicable for this particular external reference. Okay, so we don't need to worry.
Actually, a small question.
Yes.
Can you tell me the path? I'm not able to find out web services demo.dtsx.
Okay, just do one thing. Say okay over there. Okay, and just go to your solution, or just put a mouse on your package name. Okay, when you put a mouse on your package name, you will be able to see its entire path, like it's on my machine. Okay, just put a mouse on the web services demo and you will be able to see its entire path. Okay, just browse that path and browse the web services package accordingly.
Okay, thank you.
Just put a mouse over here. So once you do this configuration, after that what is going to happen is that this particular execute package task, whenever we are going to execute this package, execute package demo.dtsx, okay, it is going to call this web services demo package, okay, and it will execute the task whatever is written over here. Okay, till now we have not did a variable configuration, so don't worry about it. Okay, the variable configuration, how we can do it to pass a value from one package to another package. Okay, in the how we can do it, that I'm just going to explain you. Okay, this variable passing feature is very much useful into 2008 R2 and below version, in the previous version of SSIS, because in those project the facility to have a global variables is not available. Okay, so in those projects, like if you get some task to, you know, work on a maintenance project kind of thing, where people are using a 2008 R2 or below version, in that case, to pass a value from one package to another package, okay, they are using a certain kind of configuration. We call it as a parent package variable configuration, okay, using which you can pass a value of one variable from one package to another package. So how we can perform this activity, that I'm just going to show you next in this demo. Okay, but before we go into that, is everyone done with this execute package demo configuration? Anyone who is doing it and want me to wait for a minute, or I can go ahead with the configuration?
Oh, actually I'm doing it later. I don't know about others.
Okay, okay, so that's fine.
But one doubt, like, but what is the purpose, like, purpose of this execute package task? We can directly execute the package directly itself, right? What's the main significance?
You can execute this package directly, you know, like package one by one. But let's say in your solution you have a 15 or 20 packages, okay, and you want to create one master package, okay,
uh-huh,
which can control the overall execution of all your SSIS packages, okay. So in that case, you can just use this execute package task component into your one master package, okay, and you can just control the flow from here, that which particular package you want to run first and how you want to navigate the package executions. So for all those kind of tasks, things, this execute package task is being used.
Like, we can include in one package, in one execute package, or we can include more than one package?
Yes. We can just add it over here, the second execute package task as well. Okay. This package,
okay,
we can reference it to some other package, like let's say DIM geography or DIM product. Okay. And you can just say that, you know, after executing this package task, let's execute this particular package. So those kind of configuration, we do it over here.
Okay. Yeah, fine. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So now I'm just going to show you how we can do this. Here we have just configured now. We have did a configuration for this package, you know, to call this particular web services package. But in the web services package, we have not did any changes to receive a value that is stored in this particular variable test code. Okay, so to perform this activity, we just need to use one configuration that is called a parent package variable configuration. Okay, and how we can do this configuration, that I'm just going to show next. So for that purpose, we just need to go to our child package. Okay, here I'm going to reference this execute package as our parent package, and this web services package is our child package. Okay, this is our child package which we are going to call from this particular parent execute package demo. Okay, so here I'm just going to this package, child package web services demo.dtsx. okay, and in this package I'm just going to go to its property. Okay, so if I go to the property window for a particular package, okay, I will be able to see one of the property over here as a configurations, okay, and against which the collection is written. Okay, this particular configurations are available over here to perform various configurations. Here basically the various configurations options are available. Okay, so what are the configuration options that I'm just going to cover one by one in our upcoming demos. Okay, in today's session we are just going to use one of the configurations. So for that purpose, I have just click on the, in this collection window, I have just click on this button over here. Okay, and when I click on the button, I'm just going to get a window which looks something like this. Okay, in this window, I just need to click on this checkbox that says enable a package configuration. Okay, and here we can add our package configurations. Okay, I'm just saying add over here. Okay, when I click on the add, I will get a utility which looks something like this that says welcome to the package configuration wizard. Okay, here I can go to the next, and when I go to the next, I can just get a window which looks something like this. Okay, through this window we can configure our SSIS value, SSIS package value. We can just configure using this particular utility. Okay, so there are different options available over here, like all the values which we want to keep a configurable from our SSIS package, like our connection string or variables or something. Okay, then all those kind of configurable value we can just create from here. Okay, so either we can take all the configuration value into an XML file, or we can store it in some environment variable or a registry entry variable, or we can store it in some SQL Server tables, all the configuration details what you want to. And there is one configuration option available over here as a parent package variable which we are going to use in our this demo. Okay, so for now, just select this parent package variable. Okay, and after selecting this package, this variable as a parent package variable, okay, just write over here the variable name that you have created in your execute package, execute package, okay, or in your parent package. So in my parent package, I have created one variable with the name testcode. Okay, so I'm just writing that variable name over here. Okay, just make sure you only write a variable name, okay, and you maintain the uppercase and lowercase character. It should be the same name as you have in your parent package. Okay, so you just need to write the parent package variable name over here in this configuration window after selecting the parent package variable. Then you can go to the next. Okay, and in the next window, you just need to select that to which particular variable you want to assign this test code value. Okay, so here in this package, we have one variable stock code. Okay, and to this variable stock code, we want to assign a value. Okay, that is coming from this particular variable test code. Okay, so for that purpose, I'm just going to this variable stock name. Okay, and in this stock name, I'm just going to its property value. Okay, and in the value property right now, the value is assigned as a GOOG. Okay, and we want to override this value with a stock code that we are getting from our parent package. Okay, so I can just from this window, I can just select this value property, okay, of our variable stock name. Okay, so that I have just selected over here. Okay, after doing this selection, you can just go to the next window. Okay, and here you can give a name whatever you want to give. So let's say here I'm just giving a name as a parent variable config. Okay, now after doing this configuration over here, you can just say finish over here. So now your parent package variable configuration is done. Okay, it is going to read a value, like whatever package is going to call this package. Okay, and from that package, it will just read a value from this variable test code. Okay, and it will assign its value to this variable stock name. Okay, so that configuration we have just written over here. Okay, and once we are done with this configuration, we can just say close over here. Okay, let me just check one the variable name and just make sure that the variable name is here. It is a test code. Yeah. Okay. Now, after doing this activity, I'm just closing this web services demo package. Yes. Okay. And I'm just saving the and all the things, all the changes what I have there. Okay. I'm just setting this execute package task demo as a startup object. Okay. I'm checking the value that what value this particular stock detail.xml contain. So at present, I can just see that this file contains value for a stock code Google. Okay. After our execution, it should contain a value for a Bank of America. Okay. So now I'm just closing the majority of the tab over here, which we do not require. And I have just opened this. Yeah. So we just have these two tabs open, default and stock code web services. Okay. And now I'm just executing this solution. Now when I am going to execute the solution, what it is going to do is, it is just going to call that particular package that is our web services demo. Okay, and it will just execute the web services demo package also accordingly. Okay, and you can just see over here, the it has called web services demo package and execution of both the packages has been done. Okay, now if I stop this execution, okay, and see the value should be a new value. Okay, so I'm just stopping the execution over here. Okay, and now I'm just moving to this particular folder and I'm just checking a value in this file stock detail.xml, and here now I can just see that the stock code which I'm getting right now, it is for a Bank of America. Okay, so in this way we can just call a execute a one package from another package. Okay, and during the execution, if we want to pass a value of some of the variable, then those value we can pass using this parent package variable configuration. Okay, here we want to pass a one variable value, that's why I have created a one parent package variable configuration. Okay, if you want to pass a value of a multiple variables, in that case what you can do is, you can just add a multiple parent package variable configurations within your SIS package by just clicking on the add button that is available in that configuration window. Okay, so in that way, in this way, you can just basically call the one package from another package. You can just pass variables between the two exercise packages. Okay, so these are the things which I just want to cover in this execute package task demo. Any question or if you have any question on this demo, please go ahead and ask me a question.
In real time, I'm like, how frequent, like, is it, the people are going to use it very frequently?
It's depend on project. It's depend on the project requirement. But if you know you are working on a project, okay, where people are doing a development or maintenance kind of activity in the 2008 uh-huh. R2 and previous version, okay, in uh-huh. those project you might get this feature being used very heavily, okay?
Okay.
But if the project development is, you know, people are doing it using MSBI 2012, okay, mm-hmm. in that case, mm-hmm. that is one feature available over here, that is a project parameters, okay? Where here you can define a variable, okay? So here whatever mm-hmm. variable you are defining, this variable will be a global variable for this solution.
Okay.
So this variable you can access it in anywhere in this SIS packages, any of these SIS packages. So in this 2012 solution, you may not use this feature, but in the previous version, you might use this feature, because in the previous version, to pass a value from one package to another package.
No, I'm not asking about the. No, actually, I'm not asking about the parent mm-hmm. package. About the web services, I mean, like that.
That's again depend on your project to project you are working in. If they are using it, then you may use it very heavily. If they are not using it, you don't use it at all. So it's purely depend on the infrastructure of the project you are going to work on.
Okay, so they are going to provide the URL for that too, right?
Yes. So if you are going to use the web services task, then what all details you need is, you need a HTTP connection, okay? And you need this web services description language file. That's all you need.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Yep. Other question on this?
Akshay, how did you change the on the web services package? I'm sorry, I missed that one a little bit.
So the web services one, what we have did is, we have created one variable over here in the web services package, and its name is stock name. Okay. This particular variable I have used in the web services task. Like, if you see in the web services task, in the input section, I'm not providing a hard-coded value. I'm providing a value from this variable. Okay. Now, in the parent package variable configuration, what we are doing is, we are taking a value from this particular test code, okay, and this value we are overwriting, okay, to this particular variable value stock name. So this value will be changed from Google to BAC, okay, and this value is being used by our web services task. So it will automatically take this value, and it will just request a file to this web services against this BAC code. So in this way, it is just going to work. Is it clear?
But in the web services, we change something in the properties, right?
No. We have not changed something in a web services property. We have changed in the package property. In the package property, we have changed its configuration. Okay. Where in the configuration, just give me a minute. Yep. Where in the configuration, we have added one configuration over here, a parent package variable configuration, okay? And to add this parent package variable configuration, what you need to do is, you just need to click on the add button over here. You need to go next, okay? Then you need to select your connection type as a configuration type as a parent package variable. Here you can just provide the variable name, whatever variable you have in your parent package. In our parent package, we have a variable with the name test code. Okay, so that name I have written over here. Then I move to the next window. In the next window, I have selected a variable to which I want to assign this value that is coming from this variable test code. Okay, so here I have just selected our variable, that is a stock name. Okay, and in the stock name, which property of this variable stock name, you want to assign this value. Okay, so we want to assign its we want to change its value property. Okay, where the stock name's value property right now contain a value GOOG, and we want to change it to whatever value we are getting from our parent package. Okay, so for that purpose, I have used choose this property value of the variable stock name over here in this window where it says the select target property. Okay, after selecting this, I can just go to the next. Okay, and here I can just give a configuration name. So here it is also giving a summary that what you are doing is you are using a configuration type parent package variable configuration, where you are using this test code variable value which is coming from a parent package. Okay, and that value you are assigning to your variable stock codes names value property. Okay, after doing this configuration, you can just say finish over here. So now your value will be, you know, assigned from this variable test code to this variable stock. So in this way, you can just do the parent package variable configuration. Does it make sense?
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Okay. I was looking into the tasks okay. property, so I couldn't find it.
Okay, okay. Anyway, it's fine. Okay. So now here I'm just going to take a break of around 4-5 minutes. And after that, we will be looking to fuzzy lookup components. So I'm just keeping myself on a mute till that time.
Akshay?
Yes.
Yes.
Really quick, I know you're taking break, but are you gonna go over on any example for a project parameter? Like you can set it up where you can have multiple DTS package run from the main one.
Yes. 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 I'm going to use that example in our next session. Once we do a deployment, after that I will just show that example. Okay. Okay. So I'm just keeping myself on the mute, and after a break we will again begin our session after around 4-5 minutes. So hello everyone once again. All of you can hear me clearly? Yeah.
Yes, Akshay.
Yeah, okay. Now I believe with our demo with the next topic. Okay. And the next topic I'm just going to explain you is a fuzzy logic. It's a fuzzy lookup component. Okay. So you know a data transformation task. In our data flow, there are certain components available which is being used generally for a data cleansing kind of activity. Generally what happens is if your data is coming from like you are getting a data that is coming from your end users, okay? If let's say if someone is doing some survey and if he is just maintaining a data in a file, okay? In that case, what happens is a problem can occur due to the bad data. Like for example here, let's say a person is doing a survey, okay? And while doing a survey, a person will gather a data into an Excel file, okay? If it's asking a persons, okay, that in which company you are working in, then there are chances that people, you know, name the company differently. Like for example, if you see the record number 11 to 17, okay, which I have highlighted in a or which are in a blue color, you can see that if you ask someone, the person may say I am working for a Microsoft corporation. Someone enter the data like Microsoft Corp. Someone just write a Microsoft, okay. So in this manner, person can write a data or can provide data in a different manner, okay. But if you see all of this person, they belong to the same company, that is a Microsoft corporation, okay. Also there are chances that sometime when people are entering a data, okay, at that particular time they enter the bad data, okay, like they make a spelling mistake somewhere, okay, in place of Microsoft they write some another spelling by like double T or double O or something like this. So this kind of typo can also happen while getting your data directly from the end user from the some file formats like Excel or in a text file, okay. Or if in your company, like whatever web application is there, okay, if that web application's validations are not strong, in that case also you can end up with a bad data like we have over here, okay. So if you have this kind of data, and on this data if you generate some graph or something, like for example after having this survey data, if your business user want to see that what is the employee count by company, okay, which are being used in this survey, in that case if they use this data and if they generate a graph for this data, then your computer won't be able to find out the difference that what is the your computer won't be able to group Microsoft, Microsoft Corp and Microsoft Corporation into a one company, as a one company, okay. It is always going to treat as a three different company like I have provided over here, okay, and it is see an employee count in this particular manner. So which is by looking at the actual data, this is a valid graph, but for a business user this is an invalid graph because here the values are not maintained properly, okay. So this kind of scenario can happen into a real life as well, okay. So if this kind of data you have, then what people generally do is they while loading a data into their reporting environment, okay, they first clean the data, and after cleaning the data they will use that data for analysis purpose, okay. So how we can perform this cleansing kind of activity, okay, that I'm just going to show you in our next demo, okay, that how we can clean this kind of bad data and we can just provide a better result to our end user, okay. So for that purpose, generally different products are available into a market, okay, and majority of the product are product work on a fuzzy algorithms to clean this particular data, okay. In SSIS there is a component available within a data flow task, okay. So just to give you an idea on this, I'm just creating a new package over here, okay, and in this package I'm just adding a new item. I'm just giving it a name, this package as a fuzzy lookup, okay. and I'm just adding this packet into a solution. And in this fuzzy lookup package, I'm just going to add a data flow task as well. Okay, and if I just move to this data flow task, here I will be able to see in the other transformation, there are two transformation components available. One is a fuzzy lookup and one is a fuzzy grouping. Okay. So this fuzzy lookup and fuzzy grouping are the transformation that are being used to clean this particular data. Okay. So there is some specific algorithms written, okay, within this particular components. Okay. And based on that component, it will provide us some result set, okay, using which we can clean our data. Okay. So for that purpose, how we can do this cleansing? For that purpose, I'm just going to take an example. Okay. So for that purpose, if you go to your material folder, then in your material folder, under the fuzzy lookup example, I have created this two script. One is a fuzzy lookup reference value and one is a fuzzy lookup source. Okay. I just want all of you to open this two script, okay, and execute this script on your machine. Okay. The script will create a two tables. Okay. First table is a fuzzy lookup source that it will create into MSBI training source database. Okay. And second table it is going to create for the second script, just give me a minute. Let me just check one thing over here quickly. Fuzzy lookup. I might have made some mistake in this query. Just give me a minute while listing the scripts. Just give a minute. Match company staging data for each example. Fuzzy lookup matching index is not important. Okay, just do one thing. For this particular example, just go to this source MSBI training. Just open this one fuzzy lookup source. Okay, and just execute this script. MSBI training source.
Database name is different now.
Yep. Okay. So just do one thing. In place of this MSBI training source, just write a database name in the script as a training database. Okay. So in place of this MSBI training source at the top, just write this training database, that user training database. Okay. And after that, just run this script. So the script will create one table into your training database. Okay. Similarly, for a second this script, here also just change the database name as a training database. Okay, and here also just run this particular script. Okay, so once you run this script, you will be end up with a two table within your training database. One is a fuzzy lookup source and another one is a fuzzy lookup reference. Okay, just give me a minute, let me just check I have made some mistake or what. Yeah, so here let's say I have in this fuzzy lookup source, in this table I have a value like this. I have a person ID, person's name, birth date, phone number, department and a journey country. Okay, so here what I have did is in this particular department column, okay, I have purposefully put some wrong data. Okay, like if I just take this value into my Excel file, okay, and show data on this, okay, then here you can just see that in this particular column, F column, okay, I have made some spelling mistake. Like in place of marketing, I have written over here the marketing with a double T. Okay, in place of consulting, I have just made some wrong spelling. Okay, in place of technology, I have written a tech over here. Okay. In place of finance, I have written FINN over here as a short form. Okay. In place of human resource, I have written HR over here. Okay. So this kind of bad data we can have in our table. Okay. And let's say we want to clean the data that is available into this particular F column. Okay. So how we can clean this data? So to clean the data, what I have did is I have created one more table over here that is a fuzzy lookup reference value. Okay. And in this table, what I'm doing is I'm just keeping the all the valid value for a particular department, like what should be the department name. So what should be the finance spelling, what should be the marketing spelling, technology spelling, consultant spelling, human resource spelling, and BPO spelling. Okay. So I'm just keeping over here this department name over here as a valid spelling. Okay. And now we are just going to, using this particular reference value table, okay, we are just going to clean our data into this fuzzy lookup source table. Okay. So how we can perform this activity that I'm just going to show you in this particular demo. Okay. So is everyone clear about the goal, what we are going to do in this demo? Any question on that part? Okay, so I believe everyone is fine. So now I'm just moving to my SIS package, and here we have created an SIS package and added a data flow task over here. Okay, in this data flow task, I'm just putting one OLEDB connection. Okay, and this connection will be pointing to our training database because we are just going to use the tables from there. Okay. First, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to fetch a data from my source. So I'm just adding a OLDB source over here. Okay. And here I'm just going to select the data from our table. Okay. So I'm just opening this OLDB source over here. Just give a minute why it's not opening up. Just give a minute. What's happening with you? Yeah. We are just going to open it in edit mode. Okay. And here we are going to use our fuzzy lookup source table. Okay. So I'm just going into the drop down and I'm just going to choose my table. That is a fuzzy lookup source. Okay. And this table will contain a value like something like this. And we have a department column which contain this valid invalid data. Okay. I can just say close over here. Okay. And I can just go to the column section. In the column section, I can just see that all the columns are coming properly from this key. Okay. After that, I can just say OK over here. So now I'm able to fetch the data for this particular table. Okay. After that, I want to clean the data into a department column. Okay. So for that purpose, I'm just going to my other transformation. And from the other transformation, I'm just going to add a fuzzy lookup over here. Okay. And to this fuzzy lookup, I'm just going to connect my OLEDB source. Okay, here I'm just opening a fuzzy lookup component in edit mode, and when I open it in edit mode, it required a certain details. Okay, like it required what is a reference table in which our master information is stored. Okay, so that master information we have stored over here in this table, fuzzy lookup reference value. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, here I'm just going to provide this reference table name that is a fuzzy lookup reference value. Okay. After that, we have an option over here to store a new index and everything. Then I will just explain you in a sometime as a, because these are the advanced property. So I will just explain you in a minute once we have a demo on this. After selecting a table over here, reference table, I can just move to the columns window. And in the column window, I can just see that on the left hand side table, I have a columns that all I'm getting from my source. Okay. And on the right hand side, I have a column that I'm getting from my lookup table. Okay. Or from my this master table. Okay. Now what I want to do is I just want to compare the department name that is present in this input columns or a source table to the department name column that is present in my lookup table. Okay, and against this match, I want to fetch the department name. Okay, so I'm just creating this connector by just taking this by just clicking on this department name and then just moving this dragging and dropping this to the department name column over here. Okay, and I'm just selecting this department name over here in this manner. Okay, after doing the selection, what this fuzzy lookup component is going to do is it will compare the department column value, okay, in the master table into a reference table, okay, and against that value it will just generate some statistics. Okay, so what kind of statistics it will generate, that I'm just going to show you in a minute. Okay, so after doing this configuration, I'm just going to say okay over here. So now our fuzzy lookup, basic configuration of our fuzzy lookup is done. Okay, some of the property of this fuzzy lookup component I will just show you in some time. Okay, once we have a data in our database table. Okay, after that what we need to do is we just need to add a OLEDB destination over here. Okay, and in this OLEDB destination I'm just going to pass the value of my fuzzy lookup. Okay, here I'm just going to opening it in edit mode. Okay, here I do not have a table which can right now contain this kind of data. Okay, so I'm creating a table over here. So I'm clicking on the new button. Now when I click on the new button, you will be able to see that a table definition will be created, and in the table definition we have this particular column which we are getting from our source. Okay, this is a particular column which we are including from our reference table which we are including in our data set. Okay, and the last three columns, similarity, confidence and similarity department, okay, these are the column that is being generated by your fuzzy lookup component. Okay, and your fuzzy lookup component is providing some data into this particular columns. Okay, so what data it is providing and what is the usage of this data, that I'm just going to explain you in a minute. Okay, so let's just give this table some name. So let's say I'm just giving this table a name as a fuzzy lookup department cleansing department staging. Okay, so let's say that's a name I'm just giving to this table. That's fuzzy lookup department staging. Okay, and I'm just saying okay over here. Okay, and after that I'm just going to the mapping, and here also I can just see that the three new columns are added, similarity, confidence and similarity department, and I can just say okay over here. After that I just want to run this package first, show the data in the destination table, and then I will just explain you what this component is doing. Okay, so I'm just executing this package. I'm just setting it as a startup object and I'm just executing this package. Once I execute it, it will start its activity and it will just transfer the data from here to this table. Okay, after doing this activity I can just say stop over here. Okay, I can go to my database, I can just refresh the tables over here. Okay, and I can just look for the table that we have just created, fuzzy lookup department staging. Okay, and I'm just selecting the data from this table. Now the data which we have in this table, okay, it has this three additional column, similarity, confidence and similarity department. Okay, just to give you a proper view on this data, what I'm doing is I'm only selecting a person ID. First name and last name I don't require, birthday don't require, phone number I don't require, and the country I don't require over here. Okay, so I'm just selecting this particular columns. Okay, and I'm just selecting the data for this columns. Now when I select the data, I will be able to see the data which looks something like this. Okay, that this is a department second column. Okay, this is a column which we are getting from our source. Okay, this is our master data in this column, department name, which we are getting from our master data table. Okay, where we have a valid department name. Okay, and after that we have this two columns, similarity, confidence and the similarity department. Okay, so in this column you can just see some numbers. Okay, so these numbers are basically show the probability that how much data or how much the value that is present in your department column, okay, is similar to the value that is present in your column department name. Okay, so here you can just see that when the spelling are same, okay, like I'm just ordering this data by department name, order by department name. Okay, so here you can just see that, like in this result set, you can just see that for this particular third record in my result set, okay, when the value of department and department name are same, okay, it is giving over here the similarity as 100%. So what it is saying that for this value the match is 100%, so this is a valid data. Okay, for some of the other departments, like for example here the consulting and this consulting, where the consulting matches exist, it has put the value 1 over here. Okay, while in the upper row it has put the similarity between this consulting and this consulting as a 90% or 0.9. okay, because here you can just say that here in this consulting spelling we have made some mistakes, okay, and we have written a wrong spelling over here, okay, where in place of CON we have written a COUN. okay, so here it is saying that this record is not a valid record because its similarity is not 1, okay, but it is matching to this consulting value present in your department name column, okay, or present in your master table, okay, and that matches around 90%. Okay, so now based on this match value 90%, you need to decide whether you want to use this department name as a consulting or not. Okay, so basically this fuzzy lookup is going to just give us statistics like this, that how much this particular value is similar to this one. So here it has given us a value which says that this particular value is 90% match to the value department name over here. So if we want, we can just override this department value with this particular department name available over here. Okay, or similar is the case with this, like if you see the value for this marketing, okay, then for a marketing, when we have a match like 1, similarity is 1, at that time the spelling is same, okay, and when the similarity is less than 1, okay, at that time you can just see that there are minor spelling mistakes, like here we have a double T, so it is giving us that the similarity is 0.89, where we have a market only in place of marketing, in that case it is giving us a similarity as a 0.66. Okay, so these are in the kind of similarity it is giving us. Now after having this similarity figure, okay, what we can do is in our ETL package we can just write a logic, okay, whether to accept this record or not. Okay, so generally in a general scenario what happens is if the similarity is more than 70%, okay, in that case people will use the value that is given by your fuzzy lookup as a proper match value and they will pass this value to their destination table as a department name. Okay, so in that way now using the similarity value you can just clean your data table, okay, and you can just clean your data accordingly. Okay, so these are the kind of value like the similarity, confidence and similarity department that has been generated by your fuzzy lookup component. Once you have this value, then using this value, now you can clean your data. Okay, but these numbers are generated based on the fuzzy lookup algorithm that is written by Microsoft. Okay, and based on this value, we can now just clean our data. Does this example make sense to everyone? That how we can perform a data cleansing part on our data using the fuzzy lookup component? Any question on this till now?
Yes, Akshay, there is one.
Company has a different policy.
Sorry?
Each policy, like some company goes for 70%,
Yes,
or
yes.
Some company goes for
yes, it. Yes. That's purely depend on the organization to organization and the kind of data you have in your master table. Okay, like in your master table, if you have a data that is related to each other, like for example, here in your master table you have a department name that is, you know, very related to each other. For example, let's say you have a department names like marketing ABC, marketing XYZ, marketing PQR. Okay, so in all these names the first marketing is common. Okay, so in that case you will be able to see that the match value, you have to keep it a bit higher. Okay, but if all the department names are not similar to each other, in that case you can use a lower value also as your match case, like 60% or 70% or something like this. Okay, so it's purely depend on what value you have in your this reference table. Okay, and this kind of activity do not happen in a one go. Okay, to have a proper result on the data cleansing part, this activity will take like around 5 to 6 months of time. Okay, where in the first 1 month of time people just analyze the data, that what kind of data they are getting. Okay, based on that data they will prepare this master table and set up this threshold value, that based on which particular threshold value they want to clean their data. Okay, and after that, as and when a new value will come, people will learn more about data. Okay, and they will just make this threshold value or the similarity value, whatever they want to use, they use it accordingly. So this is not a, you know, activity that's happened on the first day, but it is a kind of a learning activity using which we you know, pure our data, and the result, proper result, we will be able to get after the duration of 3 to 6 months. So in that way it's generally happen.
Okay, got it.
Because to clean the data, you need to just understand that what kind of data or what kind of things you are getting. Okay, so you will understand this pattern, and based on the pattern you will just set this threshold value, that these are the threshold threshold value that you should be using to clean your particular data.
What is that confidence and similarity department?
Okay, so this confidence, the similarity is basically shown that how much the two records are similar to each other, like what is the similarity between the source and the reference column. Okay, this confidence column describe that what your fuzzy lookup algorithm thinks is a quality of the match. Okay, so what I mean by quality of the match is that if in your table, okay, if the values are related to each other. Okay, like for example, in your reference table, if you have a values like the department names which are similar to each other, okay, where the department name are similar. Okay, so in that case, this based on this particular value, department name. Okay, just give me a minute. Let me just give me a minute to think, and then I will just give you an answer on this. What example should I use?
I got the point.
Yeah. So basically, this this confidence is a quality of the match. Okay, and that quality of the match is depend on the two variable. The first variable is your similarity. Okay, and the second variable it will take into account is the kind of record you handle in your kind of records you have in your this department name column in the master table. So based on this two variable, okay, it will define the probability that how much this record is similar to this one. Okay, and based on that it will just generate a number over here that this is the quality of this particular match. Okay, and this and this similarity department, it's give you a overall scenario that overall how your fuzzy algorithm thinks that these records are similar to this one. Okay, so here we are just doing applying a fuzzy lookup on the one column. Okay, so that's why we are just getting this similarity department column as a one column. But let's say if in your table you have a three columns, and on the three column you are performing a data cleansing activity. Okay, then in that case what happen is in the result set you will be getting a five columns. okay, one column for each of the column on which you are doing a cleansing. Like let's say we are doing a cleansing on a department, city and country, then in that case you will be getting a 5 columns: similarity underscore department, first column; second column will be underscore similarity underscore city; third column will be underscore similarity underscore country. Okay, so these are the individual similarity that it is found, okay, for a particular records. Okay, and after that it will create these two columns, similarity and confidence, which will give you a overall picture of a particular record. Okay, that what is a combined city, country and department value is for this particular record is matching with the overall value present in your reference table for the country, city and department. So in this way it will just generate this record. So this similarity department is the actual match for this department similarity over here, while this similarity and confidence, it will just give you an overview of the entire record that you have in your cleansing activity.
Okay.
Does it make sense?
Yep. Yes, actually. Thank you.
So in this manner, we can just have this statistics.
Akshay, I have one question. In this manner, we can just have this statistics.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, the department is a nice example because you can reference the table and you can match. How about the street address? Because that one seems to be some problem, like 123 South Drive, and the other customer has other customer has 123 South DR.
So for that purpose, what happens is generally this kind of databases are available in the market, okay, and which people generally purchase. Like for example, if you talk about the country USA, okay, and then on the Microsoft cloud, okay, the data is available which contain the all the address, country, city, zip code details, okay, in the form of a database tables, okay. So if you want to clean that data, then from the market or from the cloud, you can just purchase this data, or in some of the sources you can get this data for free. Okay, like on the Microsoft cloud, you can get a data for USA for free. Okay, so you can get that data, you can have that data into your tables. Okay, and then you can just use those values as a reference value. Does it answer your question? But that data basically you need to purchase. You need to purchase or you need to get that valid data from somewhere. So if you are doing, okay. So now after doing this particular things, okay, what you can do is you can just use a conditional split component or something like this, okay. And based on that, you can just put some data into your destination table, or you can just, like, based on your business rules, you can either put all the data into the destination table, or you can drive a data into two different table and provide some kind of exception report to your business user in an Excel file that these are the report which are not at all matching. Okay, so those kind of things you can just do it over here. Now I want to just explain you that how this fuzzy lookup component work internally. Okay. So here what's happening is that if I go to this fuzzy lookup component, okay, and if I go to its property over here in the advanced tab, okay, in the advanced tab you can just see that here I have here the one value is written by default, okay, and what is seeing and what text written over here is that minimum number of matches to output per column. Okay, so how your fuzzy lookup work is that for each of the record that you have in your source table, okay, so for all the record for every record in this fuzzy lookup source value in this table, okay, it will take a department, okay, and that department it will compare to all value that is present in this fuzzy lookup reference table. Okay, so it will contain, let's say for a first record they are getting a department as a marketing, okay. So that marketing value, that marketing name, it will compare with this all six records that is available in this reference value table. Okay, against each of this record, okay, it will get a some probability number from a fuzzy lookup component that this particular department name is matched to finance this person, marketing to this person, technology to this person, consulting to this person, and so on. Okay. Out of this six comparison, whatever is the highest match, okay, that match is being used over here to perform the matching. Okay. Why we have only considered the highest match over here? Because we have written a number as a 1 over here. Okay. So that means it is only taking the highest match whatever it is getting. Okay. If in some case, if your business user says that they want to take a 2 matches or 2 probable matches. Okay. If you have a too much messed up data and you want to take a 2 highest matches or 3 highest matches. In that case, you just need to write this number as a 2 or 3. Okay. So if I write a number 2 over here, then in that case, what's going to happen is the marketing spelling, it will compare with all these 6 records. Okay. And out of the 6 record, which are the 2 records with the highest matching probability. Okay. Those 2 records, it will just provide us in our result set. Okay. So for every 1 record, we will be having the 2 records as a matching. Okay. So you will be able to see over here that in this result set, rather than having a 18 records at present, we will be having a double number of records in our result set. Okay. So if we have a too much messed up data and if your business user wanted just for an analysis purpose to see the corresponding matching scenario and how this component is working, in that case, you can just change the property over here and you can just select that whatever number of maximum matches you want to consider in your result set. Okay. The second thing is this similarity threshold. The similarity threshold is available like right now it is placed to 0.0. Okay. If you increase this value, then what it is going to do is that if the, let's say if I just set it to 0.6, then what it is going to do is that whatever record it will get where the similarity is less than 60%, it will automatically put that value as a 0. Okay. And only for a higher number of records where the similarity is 60% or more, for those records only it will show an actual probability number. Okay. So if you want those kind of result set, then that property you can just configure over here. Okay. And here there are some token delimiters available. Okay, that means while applying this fuzzy lookup, okay, if you want to ignore certain characters, okay, or you want to ignore some characters or some particular values, okay, then those particular string or value, you can just write it over here, okay. So those particular delimiters will be excluded or included within your corresponding match and your match results will be generated based on that, okay. So these are some of the property for which you can just do a configuration from this place, okay. And over here in the reference table tab, we have this store index column available over here, okay. What this store column index do is, if you enable this store index, okay, and if you just select this option, maintain a store index, okay, what it will do is, it will create one table within your database, the same database, training database, okay, in which it will keep this, it will create a some kind of indexes, okay, that will improve the performance of your fuzzy lookup component, okay. So whatever value you have in your reference table, on that table, it will just generate some, indexes, okay, and that indexes, it will just keep in some dynamic table, okay. And that it will just use at a runtime. Okay. So if you want to, if you are working with a very large amount of data, okay, where in your reference table you have a 500 or 600 record or more than those value, in that case, you might prefer to go for this option to create a new indexes. Okay. And you may want to, and you can just use this option to boost the performance of your particular SSIS package. Okay. So this is like one of the components which you can use to clean your data, okay. And in this example, I'm just going to explain you that, you know, this is a way in which you can just perform this activity. Okay. Now, any question on this fuzzy lookup component from anyone. I'm just getting your echo from someone's mic constantly, so please mute your mic if you're not using it.